so conflicts of interest. I work for the German Organ Donation Foundation as a contracted and certified diagnosing physician of brain death. So I'm pretty pro this whole affair and pro organ donation, of course. So that is my sort of bias, but I hope you won't mind. I will talk about the very quickly about the worldwide organ procurement dilemma, and then what happens to the organs after brain death, how organ protective critical care could look like, show you some protocols that are out there in the literature, then about hormone substitution and corticosteroids in particular, and eventually do a little summary. Are you happy? All right. So, you see it in Europe, you see it in the UK, you see it in the United States, you see it everywhere. We have a waiting list and we have just not enough organs to fulfill that need. So here always you have the waiting list up here, and then you have the numbers of transplants, and that number didn't change so much over the years. So there is definitely a dilemma and a discrepancy, and that means we have to fight for any organ that we can get, and we have to make sure that organ is healthy and can be transplanted. And made in Germany might seem to some people as a guarantee for quality and achievement. Sadly, I have to say, when it comes to achievement in organ donation, we are really not number one. So look at the numbers here. This is organ donation per million, and that is Spain, number one, here with 34. So I heard you work together very closely with Spain with that regard, so maybe you should stick to them, because Germany is down here with 16, so we are not very far apart. And actually, organ donation is declining at the moment in Germany. We have a really severe problem, and that might have a number of reasons. We have a very old transplant law that has just been revised slightly. We have the family consensus version, so that is not an opt-out version, it's an active opt-in version. The family has actively to say, yes, we are pro-organ donation. It's not that, like I understood here, that everyone's an organ donator principally, and just if the family objects, you cannot do it. And that makes a big, big difference. Also, there's no acceptance of non-heartbeating donation in Germany. Now, our politicians have done a number of things. They have made a campaign, they gave us a new organ donation passport to carry around, and they did an information campaign in which the insurance companies now on a regular basis contact their members and tell them about organ donation and asked all their members to carry a passport and say, yes, I would. So, but right in that episode, unfortunately, we had some little transplant scandals where in some centers the transplant surgeons try to raise their number of operations by giving the organs to people who are lower on the list. So some bad black sheep ruined a lot of the whole campaign, and the trust in the whole affair, unfortunately, now is scattered in Germany. So we have a problem there, unfortunately, but we are doing a lot to get over it. The situation is that in the intensive care unit, if somebody is brain dead, we have to make sure that the organs do well and that we don't lose much time to transplantation. Now, what happens after brain death? We see a systemic failure that that consists of certain aspects. First of all, the organs might already be damaged by the primary insult. Maybe there's a polytrauma patient that has organ damage anyway, or by ICU complications such as ventilation-associated pneumonia or things like this. But the brain death itself leads to a couple of things that are not very good. For example, at the time of herniation, you will have a catecholamine storm giving you arrhythmias and hypertension, but then after that, you will see circulatory failure with hypotension and low perfusion of the organs. And then comes the hypothalamic pituitary failure, where you lack a number of very important hormones, so that will give you more troubles in terms of stable circulation. You see electrolyte disorders, you see temperature dysregulation, and all sorts of things. If you are more interested in that, I recommend this publication here by a colleague of our center who put it all together. And there you see that especially the brainstem ischemia on certain levels will give you problems with the sympathetic and the parasympathetic activity. And most of the time you will have in the beginning this catecholamine or autonomic storm with hypertension, but then that is followed by an overactivity of the parasympathetic system. And also with spinal cord ischemia, you have a loss of vasomotor tone. So that all leads to hypotension. Oh, actually, it cannot be read very well. And the other thing is that with damage to the pituitary gland, you won't have antidiuretic hormone anymore, so yet you get diabetes insipidus, and that gives you hypovolemia, and that again will add to the hypotension. And as if that would not be enough, with the loss of thermoregulation and with other inflammatory responses to brain death, you will also have malfunction of platelets and coagulopathy. So these are really the things that that are central in that situation: hypotension and hypovolemia. So that is probably what you have to care about most in that situation. It is very important to continue your critical care monitoring, the basic monitoring, but you might also consider advanced hemodynamic monitoring with PICO or pulmonary catheter, just to make sure that the circulation situation remains stable. You definitely have to balance and monitor your ins and outs of the fluids, and you have to do regular lab tests like blood gas analysis and electrolytes. And then you should also consider specific organ function tests such as echocardiography or bronchoscopy. I mean, that will be done anyway if there's the question whether we can transplant that organ or not. But maybe you should just do that early enough to pick up left ventricular function and then react with your management. So there are a number of nice publications, for example, this one from the British Journal of Anesthesiology, that give you very detailed accounts of what you have to take care of in the brain dead organ donor. The key thing is to keep circulation stable. That means the pressure and also the fluids, to make sure the electrolytes are where they belong, and take care of nutrition, temperature, treat infections, and then maybe, we'll talk about that more specifically, replace some hormones. So there have been suggestions as to what goals you should meet. And for example, there's the United Network for Organ Sharing that in 1999 set up certain goals. There's also a Canadian forum who proposed goals. And in the past, there was the rule of 100, meaning that you should aim for a PaO2 of 100 and hemoglobin of at least 100 gram, and so on and so forth. So that is better to memorize. But they are all pretty close to what you would want to achieve in any critical care patient anyway. So that is it in a nutshell. You have to continue good critical care. You have to realize this is not a dead body. This is a patient who is brain dead, and because he might go to organ donation, I have to carry on with my good critical care, and I have to do as good as I can. And then there might be some special situations in which you would want to substitute some hormones. So there are protocols for that. Very, very detailed protocols, or less detailed protocols, but they drive all in the pretty similar direction of meeting the goals that I just showed you. Again, I think this publication here is quite helpful for a fairly easy and not so complex protocol that you can use for managing the organ donor. So are these protocols effective at all? Do they help? There was this study last year, prospective study, where they looked at whether 9 predefined goals, very similar to the ones I just showed you, would be fulfilled, and what would that mean? So they looked at 380 donors, and they defined organ donation success if 4 organs or more were transplanted. And they found out that predictors of organ donation success was a lower age, a lower creatinine, I think we all can understand that, and if these goals were met prior to organ explantation. So it seems to have an impact. And then part of the organ donation protocol management is also hormone replacement. And that means, for example, methylprednisolone, vasopressin, or the thyroid hormones, triiodothyronine or thyroxine. And indeed, there have been quite a number of studies on hormone replacement to suggest that you end up with more transplantation and better organ functions for lungs, kidneys, hearts, liver. It has all been shown. The problem is that most of these studies were retrospective, quite heterogeneous, and they had a short follow-up. So they were, in terms of quality, they were not all so great. And actually, there are some more recent studies where they looked at, actually that was not a retrospective study, that was a prospective study, that's a mistake here. This is a very nice study where they looked at 130 potential donors that they treated with a so-called high-dose steroid regime with methylprednisolone 15 mg per kg, which is fairly widespread regime, and a so-called low-dose steroid regime with hydrocortisone 300 milligram. So that was how they started, and then they could have repeat doses. I mean, you see right away that it's not only compare different dosages, but also 2 different types of steroids. So that should be mentioned too, I think. But what they saw was that there was no difference in organ function or transplant numbers and lower glucose and less insulin requirement in the low dose group. So it was enough to give hydrocortisone to these patients. And then there's another interesting study, a randomized controlled study in 3 centers, looking at 300 organ donors and more than 450 kidney recipients. And they were looking at post-transplantation acute renal failure. And they randomized the patient to either getting 1 gram of methylprednisolone or placebo, just saline. And here are the results. There was no difference in acute renal failure. There was no difference in creatinine, although they put in a lot of effort to really demonstrate the anti-inflammatory effects of the steroids. They did very sophisticated genome tests to see that what was wanted, i.e. to immunosuppress this inflammatory response with methylprednisolone, did happen, yet it did not change or improve the organ function. So it is questionable whether this high-dose methylprednisolone regime really should have his place. And there's a very nice systematic review, and I really recommend it to everyone who's interested in that, by Rech, looking at the studies and did a meta-analysis, and we have no time to go in details here, but actually the hormone replacement therapies, different therapies, they seem to be of limited effect. they could not put all the studies to a quantitative meta-analysis, but many of those, 8 actually, and 20 others were undergoing a qualitative analysis that is also quite interesting. For example, it showed that lung protective ventilation seems to be a good thing. The other thing was that, again, methylprednisolone did not really show as a positive effect, with exception, I think, for liver donation. Anyway, my summary is that brain death is a status of continuous organ compromise, and that has to be understood and appreciated. The most important aspects about it are circulatory and hormonal failure, and it's probably most important to have any protocol to follow. Everybody should know what to do with the patient as soon as brain death is there. And the true effect of hormone replacement still needs to be shown. I guess the most important thing is to preserve circulation and oxygenation and shorten time to explantation. Yeah, have a brain death diagnosis early, get everything settled early, and proceed to explantation. That is the best you can do for the organs. The longer you wait, the worse they get. Thank you very much.